inspire and motivate adults to dream again. Because as we go through life and take on our different roles and responsibilities, we tend to put our dreams on the back burner. And my goal here at DawnDares2Dream is to help you pick those dreams back up and to pursue them again. Now, I want you to understand, I started DawnDares2Dream because I wanted to relay my message and my heart and my feelings across to whomever would listen. It can be difficult getting your closest family and friends to understand the way that you believe and when you try to express it and share it. So this was like my backdoor way into letting everybody know. Now, I may have lost some viewers as a result of that because they don't agree. And that's fine. I am definitely a proponent of everyone having their own thoughts, their own process, their own mindset that works for them. Your religion works for you. You keep that. No one tells you to get rid of that. Whatever it is that works for you, continue to use it. I am just saying that sprinkle some of this other information on it, this personal development information that I'm providing you, and see where your life takes you and how you take off personally. Seek it out. But always remember, we are in control of how we see our environment. I don't care what everyone says it looks like or everyone says it is. We are in control of how we choose to perceive the environment. Hey, dreamers, welcome back. And thank you to all the new dreamers who stopped by DawnDares2Dream today to see what we're all about. Well, the first thing I want to remind you guys of, the subscribe button is down here. It's red, it's rectangular. Click on that button and that way you'll be subscribed to my channel and you'll be able to see when I've posted new videos here to YouTube. And today, of course, we are still talking about my bipolar journey. And I remember maybe like in episode 4 or 5, I said that I was going to give a do's and don'ts for those who are the support system for their bipolar brother or sister. So I'm coming to you today to kind of give you a description of what I consider do's to be and what I consider don'ts to be. So we're going to start with the do's. I would say definitely let them know that you're there for them in whatever capacity that they need you. We need, or I definitely needed, people in my life who were open enough to really care and just ask how I was feeling, ask how they could assist me. Because remember, I had just been diagnosed, so I really didn't know what to expect and what not to expect. But to have people in my corner who were ready, willing, and able to be there for me, it was heartfelt. You know, my brother was one of those individuals. Now, like I told you, he had his own family, but for him calling and checking on me and stopping by occasionally, I really appreciated that because I needed that at that time. Another thing was my mother. My mother, you know, pretty much lived her own life. I lived mine. We lived separately. We saw each other when we hung out together and had fun, that kind of thing. But when it came to serious matters, we didn't really discuss them. And what I appreciated was she stood up for me and she was there. She would call and just make sure that emotionally I was fine. Because other than that, no one else really knew what to do. I would also say that you should remain the same type of friend or the same type of family member, whatever your relationship was, it should remain the same. You should not be treating this individual any differently unless they ask you to. Because remember, we're dancing a really delicate dance. We have been diagnosed with a mental illness. We are really unsure ourselves of what that means. And what we would like is our environment to remain the same as much as it possibly can. Now, of course, it's going to change some, but we really, 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 really need you to look at us the same and to act the same with us as much as possible. Another do, talk about the diagnosis. Tell your friend, your family, your lover, your cousin, your sister, your brother, how much you don't know about it and you want to get educated.
Go do some reading. That's another do. You can get educated on your own. Read up on it. And I'm not saying read a 500-page book on it. I'm saying find some stuff on the internet that talks about what it's like to be diagnosed and it be, you know, being young and not understanding. Just read up on some things, some characteristics of whatever that mental illness is, the type of support people may need with that mental illness. All these things you can find free of charge on the internet. But you want to let the person you're supporting, you want them to know that you care. And you want to show them that I've done all this research, but at the same time, that research is not them. Do you understand? That research wasn't me. I believe I had some family members who did a little bit of research to kind of understand. And that's fine and dandy. But you have to remember, there's always an exception to a rule. There's always some deviation in there. So whatever the facts they are stating may not 100% apply to the person that you know. So that's why it's important to keep the line of communication open. Keep it open, please. Pretty, please. Keep the line of communication open. Now, we're going to talk about a couple of big don'ts. Now, I have been in a few relationships since I've been diagnosed as being bipolar. One relationship was my son's dad. And of course, when I'm in a relationship with someone for real, I'm going to tell them about my diagnosis because they need to know, they need to understand. Now, this individual, I'll call him, he would mention anything that I did that was negative in his opinion. He would go, well, is that you being bipolar? Is that a symptom? Is that, you know, y'all don't know how crazy that drove me because I'm a very strong-willed, in-your-face type of woman, period. So a lot of my personality is pretty strong. Then, okay, I have some tendencies of being agitated or irritable because of being bipolar. They don't always go hand in hand. Now, sometimes I'm just in your face and I am who I am and it has nothing to do with the bipolar swing. Then there are other times where I'm in my face, I am who I am, and then you place bipolar on top of that, and the irritability that I can feel, I can come off more brash than I already am. But you have to remember, I'm a girl who grew up in Baltimore, Maryland, and I had like an edge to me, especially during the time when me and him were together. It's been about 7-8 years we haven't been together. So of course we grow and we change some. So I think I might be a little bit more milder. I don't know. You have to ask the people who I hang out with. But I couldn't stand that. Don't ask me every time I'm like up or down or irritable or whatever. Is this you, a bipolar thing? It was the most irritating thing in the world. If I'm not doing anything that's really that out of hand, I don't need you bringing it up. I really don't, because so-called normal people, sane people get upset. They can be brash. So what's the difference when I do it? Do you understand? So sometimes you just need to hang back and figure out what the new normal is for that individual and not call them out on everything. Another don't is to tell the person to not take their medication. Because you don't think they need it. You are not a doctor. You are not a psychiatrist. You are not a psychologist either. You don't know why they prescribe those meds to them. You don't know exactly what those meds are supposed to do. And for you to say not to take them is kind of borderline, completely unsupportive. Okay, now my son's dad, he meets me and he tells me he doesn't believe that I'm bipolar. And this is initially. You know, he doesn't believe that I'm bipolar and he didn't want me to take my medication. So I had a psychiatrist, actually the same psychiatrist that I have now. And I talked to her and I'm like, should I not take my meds or can I not take my meds? Do I have that option? And she basically said, you cannot take your meds. But what her advice was that I be in talk therapy while I was off of my meds. So that I was dealing with someone on a pretty regular basis who could tell when I was swinging and if I was swinging in a very bad way. So we did that. I went off my meds and I will tell you, it ended up being horrible at the end. I think I was off my meds for about a year. I think it could have been just 6 months. I don't know, but maybe somewhere between 6 months to a year, I was off my meds. And at the end, it wasn't a pretty sight. So that is a story that I will tell you in another video because this video is about do's and don'ts. And I know personally, I listened to this individual. I figured I had a support system, so I would go off my meds. It wasn't good. It wasn't a good look. It wasn't a good look for me. I have issues sleeping, so I maintained that. I self-medicated back at that point with a lot of alcohol because I couldn't sleep. I took melatonin because he said melatonin works, but melatonin works on a regular person. You know, melatonin would help me a little bit, but I needed the alcohol on top of it. So I did a lot of self-medicating in that year that kind of kept me teeter-tottering, I'll say. But eventually there was a crash because there's always a crash. Now, I didn't. No, I take that back. There's always a crash. I will tell you that complete story later, but don't do that. Do not tell someone they shouldn't take their meds. Let them take their meds and let them work out what the meds are doing to them with their psychiatrist. I am going to do another video where I talk about what it's like dealing with your psychiatrist and how the open lines of communication need to be there so that they know how the meds are impacting your life. Because if they're not working for you, they may need to change them up. So we'll talk about the different medications that I went through before I got on what I am now, where I'm pretty stable, I guess you would say, because I've been on these meds for years. It's almost like I never took anything else, but I have. So we'll talk about that. I guess I'll end this with saying, it's just important that you support your newly diagnosed person, family member, friend in your life. It's important that they have someone that is there for them, who knew them before meds and their behavior, and who also knows them now. Don't run away because we need you. I moved to Texas, like I told you in the last episode. I moved to Texas, and me moving to Texas was very difficult because I was coming to a place where I knew no one except my dad, and no one knew me. I didn't even know Houston. It was very difficult. Now, I'm a people person, so I met people. I had surface friends, and I had deep relationship friends. So I ended up being okay, but like I told you, I was telling everybody I was bipolar because I needed them to be able to watch out. But the catch is this. They were all new. So they don't know the old Dawn and my old behaviors and who I was off of medication. They only know the girl on meds because that's how they met me. That's why it's important for you to stay around if you know the individual. If you've been with them, you've been a roommate, if you are in a relationship with them, you need to maintain that relationship for them. I mean, at least 6 months to a year, because they need someone in their life who understands who they really are and aren't just second guessing everything that they do because they don't know the person prior. That's what happened to me. My son's dad met me taking meds. So he said, you don't need to take medication. You are fine. But I think the meds helped out a lot is what happened. And when I went off the meds, that's when I was kind of like teeter-tottering a lot. So, but he doesn't know what I was like before the meds either. So it's important to stay in their life, maintain those relationships as much as you possibly can. Now, I'm not telling you to stay in an abusive relationship. If the person that was mentally ill was abusing you and now they're taking medication, they're still abusing you. No, I'm not telling you to stay in something like that. I'm just saying if the relationship was as healthy as they can be, hang around because we need you. We need the support. Now, granted, we will survive without you, because we will find other support systems. There are groups, there's therapy that can help us get through and make it. Talking to other people who are like yourself and have similar experiences or feelings and to see how they deal with their anxiety and their depression and what everybody does, it is inspiring. It gives you hope. It makes you understand that life isn't gonna always be in this unstable phase. Everything is going to level out for you and you will find your new normal. If you like this video, give me thumbs up. Also, remember there's a share button down here. Okay. I want you to share that to social media platforms, share that to Facebook. I want people to know. I want people to hear about my bipolar journey because I believe there are other people out here just like myself who are trying to figure it out. And I just want you to know I've been diagnosed for 18 years now. And I figured a few things out for me. And some of those tips may work for you. I also want people who are not diagnosed, but they have people in their lives who are mentally ill. I want them to watch these videos because they can understand now, oh, that's why he was like that. Oh, yeah, that's why she was like that. they can understand some of the reactions that they may have gotten from their friend or family member or significant other in their life. Also, my face is going to be up here in a circle. I want you to click on my face, select the gray bell, select all, and that way you'll be subscribed to my channel and you'll be alerted to all the new content that I place here on YouTube. And last, I am going to have the playlist up here as well, okay, for the bipolar series. So if you've missed any episodes, I suggest that you go back and take a look because they kind of are linked together. I try my best to give you a little bit of history before I say something that I know you won't understand if you haven't watched the videos, but it's important that you go back and take a look at the other videos because they are going to help place a lot of clarity on what it is that I'm saying. Have a great day, dreamers!